June 22nd, Daily Video Bible Reading from the NET Bible, 1 Chronicles chapters 9 through 11 of the Old Testament. Genealogical records were kept for all Israel. They are recorded in the Scroll of the Kings of Israel. The people of Judah were carried away to Babylon because of their unfaithfulness. The first to resettle on their property and in their cities were some Israelites, priests, Levites, and temple servants, some from the tribes of Judah, Benjamin, and Ephraim and Manasseh settled in Jerusalem. The settlers included Uthai, son of Ammihud, son of Omri, son of Imri, son of Bani, who was a descendant of Perez, son of Judah. From the Shilonites, Isaiah, the firstborn, and his sons. From the descendants of Zerah, Geuel, their relatives numbered 690. From the descendants of Benjamin, Salu, son of Meshullam, son of Hodiva, son of Hasanua, Ibnea, son of Geroam, Elah, son of Uzai, son of Mikrai, and Meshullam, son of Shephatiah, son of Ruel, son of Ibnijah. Their relatives, listed in their genealogical records, numbered 956. All these men were leaders of their families. From the priest, Jedidiah, Jehoarib, Jachin, Azariah, son of Hilkiah, son of Meshullam, son of Zadok, son of Meraioth, son of Ahitub, the leader in God's temple. Adaiah, son of Jeroam, son of Pashur, son of Malchijah, and Maasai, son of Adiel, son of Jazirah, son of Meshullam, son of Meshullamith, son of Immer. Their relatives, who were leaders of their families, numbered 1,760. They were capable men who were assigned to carry out the various tasks of service in God's temple. From the Levites, Shemaiah, son of Hashub, son of Azrakim, son of Hashabiah, a descendant of Merari, Bakbakar, Hiresh, Galel, Mattaniah, son of Micah, son of Zichri, son of Asaph, Obadiah, son of Shemaiah, son of Galel, son of Jeduthun, and Berechiah, son of Asa, son of Elkaniah, who lived among the settlements of the Netophathites. The gatekeepers were Shalom, Akkub, Talmon, Ahiman, and their brothers. Shalom was the leader. He serves to this day at the king's gate on the east. These were the gatekeepers from the camp of the descendants of Levi. Shalom, son of Kor, son of Ebiasaph, son of Korah, and his relatives from his family, the Korahites, were assigned to guard the entrance to the sanctuary. Their ancestors had guarded the entrance to the Lord's dwelling place. Phinehas, son of Eleazar, had been their leader in earlier times, and the Lord was with him. Zechariah, son of Meshelemiah, was a guard at the entrance to the meeting tent. All those selected to be gatekeepers at the entrance numbered 212. Their names were recorded in the genealogical records of their settlements. David and Samuel the prophet had appointed them to their position. They and their descendants were assigned to guard the gates of the Lord's sanctuary, that is, the tabernacle. The gatekeepers were posted on all four sides, east, west, north, and south. Their relatives who lived in their settlements came from time to time and served with them for 7-day periods. The four head gatekeepers, who were Levites, were assigned to guard the storerooms and treasuries in God's sanctuary. They would spend the night in their post all around God's sanctuary, for they were assigned to guard it and would open it with the key every morning. Some of them were in charge of the articles used by those who served. They counted them when they brought them in and when they brought them out. Some of them were in charge of the equipment and articles of the sanctuary, as well as the flour, wine, olive oil, incense and spices, but some of the priests mix the spices. Mattathiah, a Levite, the firstborn son of Shallum, the Korahite, was in charge of baking the bread for offerings. Some of the Kohathites, their relatives, were in charge of preparing the bread that is displayed each Sabbath. The musicians and Levite family leaders stayed in rooms at the sanctuary and were exempt from other duties, for day and night they had to carry out their assigned task. These were the family leaders of the Levites, as listed in the genealogical records. They lived in Jerusalem. Jael, the father of Gibeon, lived in Gibeon. His wife was Maacah. His firstborn son was Abdon, followed by Zur, Kish, Baal, Ner, Nadab, Gedor, Ahio, Zechariah, and Mikloth. Mikloth was the father of Shimeam. They also lived near their relatives in Jerusalem. Ner was the father of Kish, and Kish was the father of Saul. Saul was the father of Jonathan, Malchishua, Abinadab, and Eshbal. The son of Jonathan, Meribbaal, who was the father of Micah. The sons of Micah, Pithon, Melech, Tariah, and Ahaz. Ahaz was the father of Jairah, and Jairah was the father of Alemeth, Azmaveth, and Zimri. Zimri was the father of Moza, and Moza was the father of Biniah. His son was Rephaiah, whose son was Eliasa, whose son was Azel. Azel had 6 sons: Azrikam, his firstborn, followed by Ishmael, Shiriah, Obadiah, and Hanan. These were the sons of Azel. Now the Philistines fought against Israel. The Israelites fled before the Philistines, and many of them fell dead on Mount Gilboa. The Philistines stayed right on the heels of Saul and his sons. They struck down Saul's sons Jonathan, Abinadab, and Malchishua. The battle was thick around Saul. The archer spotted him and wounded him. Saul told his armor-bearer, "Draw your sword and stab me with it. Otherwise, these uncircumcised people will come and torture me." But his armor-bearer refused to do it because he was very afraid. So Saul took the sword and fell on it. When his armor-bearer saw that Saul was dead, he also fell on his sword and died. So Saul and his 3 sons died. His whole household died together. When all the Israelites who were in the valley saw that the army had fled, and that Saul and his sons were dead, they abandoned their cities and fled. The Philistines came and occupied them. The next day, when the Philistines came to strip loot from the corpses, they discovered Saul and his sons lying dead on Mount Gilboa. They stripped his corpse, and then carried off his head and his armor. They sent messengers throughout the land of the Philistines, proclaiming the news to their idols and their people. They placed his armor in the temple of their gods, and hung his head in the temple of Dagon. When all the residents of Jabesh-Gilead heard about everything the Philistines had done to Saul, all the warriors went and recovered the bodies of Saul and his sons and brought them to Jabesh. They buried their remains under the oak tree in Jabesh and fasted for 7 days. So Saul died because he was unfaithful to the Lord and did not obey the Lord's instructions. He even tried to conjure up underworld spirits. He did not seek the Lord's guidance, so the Lord killed him and transferred the kingdom to David, son of Jesse. All Israel joined David at Hebron and said, "Look, we are your very flesh and blood. In the past, even when Saul was king, you were Israel's commanding general. The Lord, your God, said to you, 'You will shepherd my people, Israel. You will rule over my people, Israel.'" When all the leaders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, David made an arrangement with them in Hebron before the Lord. They anointed David king over Israel, just as the Lord had announced through Samuel. David and the whole Israelite army advanced to Jerusalem, that is, Jebus. The Jebusites, the land's original inhabitants, lived there. The residents of Jebus said to David, "You cannot invade this place." But David captured the fortress of Zion. that is, the city of David. David said, "Whoever attacks the Jebusites first will become commanding general." So Joab, son of Zeruiah, attacked first and became commander. David lived in the fortress. For this reason, it is called the City of David. He built up the city around it from the terrace to the surrounding walls. Joab restored the rest of the city. David's power steadily grew, for the Lord who commands armies was with him. These were the leaders of David's warriors, who helped establish and stabilize his rule over all Israel, in accordance with the Lord's word. This is the list of David's warriors. Jashobeam, a Hachmonite, was head of the officers. He killed 300 men with his spear in a single battle. Next in command was Eleazar, son of Dodo the Hoite. He was one of the three elite warriors. He was with David in Pass Damon when the Philistines assembled there for battle. In an area of the field that was full of barley, the army retreated before the Philistines. But then they made a stand in the middle of that area. They defended it and defeated the Philistines. The Lord gave them a great victory. Three of the 30 leaders went down to David at the rocky cliff at the cave of Adullam, where a Philistine force was camped in the valley of Rephaim. David was in the stronghold at that time, while a Philistine garrison was in Bethlehem. David was thirsty and said, "How I wish someone would give me some water to drink from the cistern in Bethlehem near the city gate." So the three elite warriors broke through the Philistine forces and drew some water from the cistern in Bethlehem near the city gate. They carried it back to David, but David refused to drink it. He poured it out as a drink offering to the Lord and said, "God forbid that I should do this. Should I drink the blood of these men who risked their lives?" Because they risked their lives to bring it to him, he refused to drink it. Such were the exploits of the three elite warriors. Abishai, the brother of Joab, was head of the three elite warriors. He killed 300 men with his spear and gained fame along with the three elite warriors. From the three, he was given double honor, and he became their officer, even though he was not one of them. Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, was a brave warrior from Kabzeel, who performed great exploits. He struck down the two sons of Ariel of Moab. He also went down and killed a lion inside a cistern on a snowy day. He even killed an Egyptian who was 7.5 feet tall. The Egyptian had a spear as big as the crossbeam of a weaver's loom. Benaiah attacked him with a club. He grabbed the spear out of the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own spear. Such were the exploits of Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, who gained fame along with the three elite warriors. He received honor from the 30 warriors, though he was not one of the three elite warriors. David put him in charge of his bodyguard. The mighty warriors were Asahel, the brother of Joab, Elhanan, son of Dodo from Bethlehem, Shammath the Hararite, Helez the Pelonite, Ira son of Ikkesh the Tekoite, Abiezer the Anathothite, Sibbekai the Hushathite, Eli the Hohite, Maharai the Netophathite, Helad son of Baana the Netophathite, Ithai son of Ribai from Gibeah in Benjaminite territory, Benaiah the Pirathonite, Hirai from the valleys of Gaash, Abiel the Arbathite, Asmaveth the Beharumite, Eliaba the Shealbanite, the sons of Hashem the Gizanite, Jonathan son of Shege the Hararite, Ahiam son of Sakar the Hararite, Eliphal son of Ur, Hefer the Mekarathite, Ahijah the Pelonite, Hezro, the Carmelite, Naarai, son of Ezbai, Joel, the brother of Nathan, Mibhar, son of Hagri, Zelek, the Ammonite, Neherai, the Beerothite, the armor-bearer of Joab, son of Zeruiah, Ira, the Ithrite, Gareb, the Ithrite, Uriah, the Hittite, Zabad, son of Akli, Adoniah, son of Shiza, the Reubenite, leader of the Reubenites, and the 30 warriors with him. Hanun, son of Maacah, Jehoshaphat, the Mithnite, Uzziah, the Asherathite, Shema, and Jael, the sons of Hotham, the Aurorite, Jediael, son of Shimri, and Joha, his brother, the Tizite, Eliel, the Maavite, and Jeribai, and Joshaviah, the sons of Elnaim, and Ithma, the Moabite, Eliel, and Obed, and Jaciel, the Mezobaite. God, I think it's really interesting in Chronicles how the person who wrote it was not focused on our worldly situations, but so focused on you. You know, it says, David's power steadily grew, for the Lord who commands armies was with him. And everything keeps pointing back to you, as it should. But in this, anything that has to do with David or Solomon or those types of situations where they had personal situations going on, David and Bathsheba and their firstborn child and all those things, all of those things are, I don't want to say glossed over, but are kind of set aside so that what you had did in David's life and what you did in Solomon's life, as well as other people, including in the armies, what you did is in the forefront of everything. It is what the focus is of this. And I think that's a really good lesson for us to keep in mind. You know, we live in this very tumultuous stage of the earth where our safety is at risk. Our political structure is built on a house of cards. The people with power are who controls all the rest of the world, or the illusion that they have the control of the rest of the world. And all of these things are going on, and we can get really trapped up in the rules and laws and politicalness and drama of what's going on in our world. And I'm not saying we shouldn't keep our eyes open, because as one of my friends pointed out, Janelle, we still need to live here. It's very true, but we need to keep in mind just what the writer of Chronicles did, which is our focus, our eyes always need to be on you, God. We know how this story ends eventually. We're probably going to go through horrid messes here on earth to get to that end result. But the end result is you, and the end result of each of our lives who are your chosen children. We know where we are going. We know what the end looks like for us. And as far as I'm concerned, this is not really my life. This stuff here on earth, this worldly stuff. My life spent here on earth is to be a complete reflection of you, so that I can start living my life when I finally go to heaven and get to spend eternity with you. God, help us to keep focus on you. Help us to keep our eyes on you. All of these other things are important because it's the world that we live in. However, we know that ultimately you are the one in control. It is your sovereignty that reigns supreme over all of these situations. We also know that you are fully aware of all of these situations and you are in control. In your son's name we pray. Amen.